Zu-Liang Sung, Honorary Secretary of the Chinese National Amateur Athletic Federation, returned home from the 1932 Los Angeles Games more resolved than ever to promote sports development in China. With the disappointing performances of Liu Chongchong, China's only athletic competitor in the LA Games, it became even clearer to Zu-Liang that having realized his first dream of having China attend the Olympics, it was time to prepare for the second dream, to send a full team to the Olympics.
When they come back from Los Angeles, everybody gave them a very big welcome, including Liu Chongchong. Everybody in the country said, think he is still a very big hero, even he didn't win any gold medals. But this, he's what he did is a big thing for the first time for China. Also, one thing my grandma told me, when my granduncle come back, he said one thing is very pity. It's not so good because we're in the big reception before and after the game held in Los Angeles. The many countries have a big delegations, many officials there. They feel their country is very strong, but only China only have one athletics and one representatives there. So they feel very lonely. So my granduncle really hoped that later, the country will send more people there, and especially more official will be there to represent the country.
自从参加了洛杉矶奥运会以后，得我们全国的这种民众，他掀起了一个什么奥运会的热点，因为以前我们中国，他许多地方是没有很好开展以西洋体育为主，也就是以奥林匹克项目为主的这方面运动，迎成了我们什么时候能够更加组织好我们奥运会的运动队，更好的到奥运会赛场上面去，代表中国，代表我们东方的这种民族。省四两先生，他作为中国最早的体育协进会的总干事，也就是说中国奥运会的秘书长，他作为中国奥运会第一团长，率领了刘长春到了洛杉矶奥运会，为中国登上世界的奥运会的舞台，也是做出了这方面贡献。所以这些前人、前辈，他为了奥运会的理想，为了奥运会的事业，他不辞劳苦，呕心沥血，在这方面为我们起了承前启后的这方面作用。
As soon as they come back from Los Angeles, the federation began to next step. They want to achieve their next from that time. So they began to well plan for the next moment. They hold a meeting in my uncle's family at the house in Shenyang University. They make some very big plan. So this time we have not sent only one, two, three, four. We should be sent more than that, maybe 100 of them to the Olympic game to show the world. But at the same time, I think the Chinese people, they already realize there is the Olympic game on the world, in the world. Everybody knows it because the first time they went to the Olympic game. So in China, everybody knows that there is an Olympic game there. So other people will love sports. They will love sports from that time. Also, there are many people besides the students who do this exercise in the school. There are many associations from that time they founded. There's a basketball, volleyball, and more people to involve the sports. So this also is good, very good for the federation to choose the good athletes from the association and the students from the school.
During that time, many universities, between the universities, they always had a lot of games there. For example, Shenyang University and Nanyang Gongxue, they regularly have the competition. Many games, football, basketball. Students, some colleges from Suzhou and Hangzhou, we enjoyed them.
With the next Olympics scheduled to be held in Berlin in 1936, the race was on to promote athletic competitions across the country and to secure the best Chinese athletes available to give them further training before the games.
So this time they select the athletes not only from school, they also select the athletes from many other associations. For example, the race walker Zhou Yuyu from Shanghai was selected by the federation. He is now a student. He works for the Baihong Sports Association in Shanghai.
Zhou Yuyu actually is was very famous during the 1930s. He was a race walking athlete. He won a lot of medals from the national games. But this time he enjoyed the Olympic team. Everybody was hope he will get something. When he come back, he told his son that the distance between China and the Western country is still a lot of distance there. We have to study very hard. But we already learned something from the Olympic game. When they come back, they say we have to really work very hard. Many other people, many famous people also told their and give some, write some letters to Zhou Yuyu. He said, hope next time you will win the game.
我亲从小就是欢喜体育锻炼，欢喜竞争，欢喜冲浪跑。就是讲，辣辣1930年，我父亲，张兆春，陈旭哲，上海呢就创建了红科田径队。到了1930年，改成共白虹田径队。搿白虹田径队辣辣中国的体育界浪也是一个邪气，有分量搿样子一个体育组织。因为包括当时辰光。 东北刘长春，一百米选手，曾经冠军选手，一些中国田径界些好的选手，包括陈宝球、赛事搿个出自于白虹田径队。据我晓得，参加奥运会之前没特别的，好像是集训，但训练呢好像是只能上海呢，大概一个号头搿样子，所有的队伍辣辣上海参加奥运会搿次队伍辣上海呢，一个号头搿样子一个集训。但是因为我父亲到了。 1936年廿八岁，所以讲伊个体育的最高的辉煌期应该讲已经过脱了，而是搿一次呢，当时辰光中国最高的体育机构，中国体育协会为了肯定我父亲对以前体育田径事业所做出的贡献，所以呢就被选为1936年柏林奥运会的选手。
When there is no participant, there will be no winner. So we have to participate, we can cheer, we can enjoy. So this enjoyment, this cheering, stays with us.
For me, it's not so important to win, and I don't think it matters. You know, Australia never wins everything. But I think it's important to be in there and be part of it, part of a global community.
Participating is definitely most important. It's the fact that so many different athletes have so much heart and commitment, they actually go there. To Olympics every 4 years, they actually display all their talent. I think that's the most important thing for the Olympics.
Much had been learned by Zu-Liang Sung during his participation in the 1932 Games in Los Angeles, and he brought all of this back to China to implement at the CNAAF.
中华体育协进会成立以后，它主要的重视是和奥运会的有关规章制度相接轨。所以说，它在全国审定我们中国运动各个项目的时候，它都是参照奥运会的这方面标准。 制定这方面的全国统一的这种这个竞赛的这方面规则，以及推广奥运会的这方面运动。So
for this point, my granduncle always think next time, next game, we do need to send a group of people there to show the world we are the big country. We not only have one athletics. So he also has the. This is his two second dreams. This is also the some the like Liu like Wang Zhengting and Zhang Boli, they all have the same feeling about that. So they can begin to prepare for the next time, the Olympic take part in Berlin. They began to select the more people who can the qualify, can enjoy the games. So start that now. At that time. They began more to put more efforts and more time to do this, to do the research for the athletics.
体育协进会，也就是中国奥委会。
他承担了组织和选拔的工作。首先，他是根据许多优秀运动员的当年的这种在全运会上的成绩做出预选，预选还是分区的，有的地方分成在北平，有的地方分在上海，有的地方分在广东。他这里边有拳击运动员，有篮球运动员，有田径运动员，有游泳运动员，所以他在选的过程当中，他是也是雇五关斩六将的，而且非常的严格。在1936年要开第十一届奥运会，当时情况，所有的媒体，所有的这个运动员都认为能够到柏林参加奥运会已经是非常了不起的事情，是一种震撼，感到就是说作为一个中国人能够是以69名运动员能够参加奥运会，这比1932年奥运会是一个巨大的进步，从一个人到一支队伍出席柏林奥运会。奥运会回来以后，所以民众呢反响非常的强烈，感到我们能够在德国柏林去和运动员一起参加，一起参加友谊竞赛，这是一件非常高兴的事情，也是非常自豪的事情。
A movement began coordinated by the CNAAF to select an Olympic team. China intended to participate in 7 sports: athletics, swimming, basketball, football, weightlifting, boxing, and cycling.
The federation, the main job for the federation, is to choose the athletics for prepare for the next game held in Berlin. So many people spend a lot of time to look everywhere in China, even they went to Hong Kong and Taiwan to see if there are anyone is qualified for the next game. Before they go to the games, the Olympic game, they choose the good athletes from the many associations in the school. Then they put them together to training them. After the training, they see the results, which one is really bad. From there, they choose the real one to go to the game. So they spend a lot of time, a lot of energy, and a lot of money on that. Also, when they ask, when they found someone is good, they just make a notes. So they spend almost 2 or 3 years to do that.
I think participation, absolutely, but human nature is we're all greedy, we all want to win. But I think the fact that you can participate is very good. You see from the last Olympics and the ones before in Australia, there was a lot of people that were very happy to be part of the, not necessarily winning, but just participating.
So you're there, you participate, you give it your best, it's an experience, it's an achievement to be performing at the Olympics. And whatever you do, you give it your best shot, you're still a winner.
I think participating, yeah, because there are so many people participating and just a few winning, so I think participating is more important. Although maybe on the contrary side, countries like US and China, they abuse it a little bit also to win the most medals of the whole game and always are in competition with each other. But for all the other athletes which are competing, I think it's especially competing. Yeah.
Putting a team together meant more than merely selecting and training athletes. For Zu-Liang to achieve his second dream, China had to come to appreciate the meaning of organized sport. In the run-up to the 1936 Olympics, he spent a good deal of his time giving speeches to the public, communicating his deep insights into the Olympics, keeping in mind the Olympic motto he encouraged his compatriots with its message, swifter, higher, stronger.
Before 1936, they said
I said they prepared a lot of time to prepare these delegations. They chose many people from not only from their school, from the students, they also chose the people from the good athletes from the other sports association. So my grand-uncle is very busy during that time. And when they select the people, so they set up a lot of games. So from these games, they choose the good athletes. Then I put them together to go some training course. Some team like football team, basketball team to the Qingdao, they also invite some foreigners as a coach. The coach was from Germany. So before they went to the game, they train a lot of time. They threw the games, many games, competitions from many schools and some associates. They hold the national games in Shanghai and in other cities. Every city has some games there. So they from every city, they get they found some good athletes.
Organizing competitions, however, took money. And with the government only partially sponsoring sports, funds had to be solicited by the CNAAF through other sources.
Because the federation is non-profit, the organization, they don't have money to pay the people to work for them. This time, many of my relatives were volunteered to work for him, as my grandpa and some old uncles. They also work for the federation. For example, there is the Shanghai is a sports ground called Jiangwan Tiyuchang. During that time, there are many of my relatives who volunteer work there. They got nothing to pay, but they were all very happy to say, hey, this is good things for the country. This sports association was organized by themselves, by the people who love the sports. Many businessmen involved in that because the first time they went to the Olympic Games, so more and more businessmen got involved. They say, hey, this is good for the country. This is good for the, maybe for their business or something. Maybe during that time, the sports are only for the rich people. I think most of the rich people do the sports because they got enough to eat, I think, so got the energies on that. So at that time, the more and more businessmen, the rich men involved in the sports. So more association was founded during that time. You can find many places, not only Shanghai, Tianjin, and Beijing, Nanjing, these big cities. Also in Suzhou, Hangzhou, this place, you can find many associations, including the basketball, football, tennis, anything.
Nor was the search for Chinese athletes restricted to the mainland. The Chinese National Amateur Athletics Federation utilized the resources whenever they existed in a major Chinese metropolis.
They also went to Hong Kong to find the football team because during that time the football team in Hong Kong is very good. So as a matter of fact, the number of the delegation, the football delegation, the most of the members is from Hong Kong, including the very famous one called Tan Bo Jiang.
Having been successful in creating nationwide improvement in sports training, the CNAAF had pushed China one step closer to achieving Zu-Liang Sung's second dream, sending a full team to the Olympics. Before setting off to Berlin in 1936, the delegation was rewarded for its efforts by an invitation from the national government to visit Nanjing, proof that amateur sports had achieved recognition. Wang Changting, Zhang Boling, and of course, Zu-Liang Sung headed to the capital to receive their accolades.
Wang Changting is the first Chinese member of IOC. Also, he is the head of the China National Amateur Athletic Federation. She also is a politician and a diplomat. He worked very hard and spent a lot of time for the Chinese sports events. Zhang Boling is also a very important person in history of Chinese sports. He is chair of board of directors, and also he is the president of Nankai University in Tianjin. With the efforts from my grand uncle and other people like Zhang Boling and Wang Zhengting, this time, the government really paid attention to the delegation. So before the delegation was sent to the Berlin game, the Jiang Jiechi, the president of China, he invited the whole delegation to Nanjing to give them some speeches and also say something, really encourage them to do things. And so you have to do some things for your country. I really hope you will get good results from the game. Also, the whole nation this time, they hope this time the delegation will bring some good results, maybe can bring home some medals. This is all the Chinese people will hope. But for my granduncle, he said, this is my second dream. The man proposed to generate this big group to the Olympic game. It means this time the sports game is more popular than before, so everybody can understand that. So everybody is many people, more and more people involved in the sports game. This is what I really want. Take part in the game is only a sample to tell them this is the big event. Then it indicates the Chinese people is really involved in the sports game.
我们的体育先驱在中国非常落后的年代，已经就是说迈出了走向奥运会的第一步，他这方面的贡献对我们后人是永远不会忘记的，也对我们后人走向奥运会的赛场起到了巨大的推动和鼓舞作用。
And so with a delegation of 69 athletes, 39 observers and 150 journalists, the Chinese team set off from a wharf in Shanghai, making history and already, without even earning a medal, achieving Zu-Liang's second dream, to send a Chinese team to the Olympics. And Zu-Liang Sung was, for the second time, with the delegation to propel China towards that goal.